Hi everyone, it's Jerry. I have an instructive game to share with you from the 1960-61 United States Chess Championship, which was held in New York. On the white end, William Lombardy, playing against Bobby Fischer. This is game 25 from Fischer's famous book, My 60 Memorable Games. So let's dive in and see what made this one memorable. The middle game features an excellent combination, but beyond that phase, the endgame. A very instructive play in that final phase. Now, on board we have an open Sicilian. Far and away most popular for white in this position is to address the threat on e4 with knight c3 right away. In this game, it's f3, noted as the Prinz variation. What is its point? And on the surface note is that it defends e4. Bigger picture, however, is that white would like to control the d5 square. White does not want to obstruct the c-pawn. So, white first plays c4, and only then knight c3. There's a fight over the d5 square. Black would like to advance d5, frequently seen as a liberating advance for Team Black. The Prinz variation is saying, not so fast. Let's get some more development in. In this position, Black castles. If Black tries d5 while the king is still on home base, it's not good for Black. White can, for instance, capture with the c-pawn and deploy the bishop to b5, pinning the knight. So before d5 is even a thought, it's castles. Now Black is ready to go with d5. White, however, says, not so fast. This retreat has unmasked the queen to defend d5. White now has how many on this square? 4. And if Black tries d5 here, there are only 3 supporters, so Black doesn't have enough. How do you get d5 in, then? How do you support this d5 move once more? Well, you don't. Fischer plays it anyway, as a gambit. This is considered the best move, and I imagine in general, moves like this have some psychological impact on an opponent. I mean, White has played many moves, played a variation that is designed to prevent this very move, yet it's still played. Where is Black's compensation for this gambit, is giving up the pawn here? Black has a lead in development, and I imagine Black also plays a move like this with an eye on the white king, who's still 2 tempi out from castles. So let's see how we continue here. White takes with a piece. If instead it's a pawn capture, a good follow-up is knight b4, targeting d5, and do know with the pawn capture, the e-file is completely open, so right around the corner, rook e8 is likely an excellent move. In this one, though, it's the piece captures on d5, and the queen exchange is declined. Black anticipates a valuable tempo one way or another on the queen. In this position, it's queen b5, considered one of the top moves is bishop e2, a step away then from kingside castles. In this one, though, it's queen b5, and now bishop d7, lining up a discovered attack after the knight moves. White ignores this, playing rook c1. So this is now the start of an excellent middle game combination. Fischer's next move is knight b4. Now, before you could play knight b4, you have to see several moves deep. Eventually, Fischer is going to find himself in a position where there is only one move that keeps an advantage for Black. Everything else and White would be completely winning. Now, this last move, what's happening? There's a problem on c2. 2 attackers. The queen is hit. a2 is hit. In the game, knight takes knight follows. If queen c4 is played here, covering all of these different threats, queen a5 is an excellent reply, setting up a discovered check, and also paving the way for more development. Another tempo against the queen. In this one, it is knight takes knight, queen takes rook check, and only then do we have the capture on b5. In the game, it's knight d5 here. If the bishop takes on b5, no problems here for black. We simply take the knight with check. Black is up the exchange. White has a pawn for it, but black is up the exchange. Here is the position after knight d5 that Fischer had to see very clearly before playing knight b4. This is where black now has only one move that keeps an advantage. I wonder if you can spot it. Feel free to pause the video. Okay, in the game it is bishop h4, check. This is a move Fischer in his book described as the scorpion's sting at the tail end of the combination. Why is this the only move that keeps an advantage for black? Well, what other options are there? If you try and save the bishop, you lose this bishop, and these two minors outweigh the rook. And if you take on f1, white doesn't take on f1. He first inserts this in-between move, knight takes bishop check, and only then scoops up the bishop. Yet again, the minors outweigh the rook. So essentially, this bishop h4 check is not allowing white to take a piece with check. That detail clearly matters. Play follows with g3. Only now do we have bishop takes on f1. King takes bishop. And now we have time to rescue the bishop. Black is better. How to proceed here? In this endgame, the knight is a very strong piece. First things first, though, let's get some developing moves in here. The bishop is maneuvering just in the nick of time to c3, not allowing this rook entry on ranks 2, rank 1. From here, f5. In general, being up this extra rook, the more open files, the better for black. So he's welcoming a pawn exchange to rip open another file. White says, I want to keep things a bit closed. The downside here for white is that the knight is now without defense, and it is now immediately challenged. In this position, it's knight b4. What other options does the knight have? Could go to e3 or f4. I want to just touch on these two moves here briefly. If knight e3, you can pretty much discount playing a move like knight to e3 because black would have f4, and this fork will crack open a file. If you try knight f4, it's a bit tricky. I feel like this might have been the better move for white to go with. Not so easy to break down white's position. There's a fork threat. It suggests rook e8 and then some play on the queen side to try and dislodge this strong bishop post. In this one, though, it is knight b4, and this allows a minor piece exchange, kicking off with bishop a5, a3, and bishop takes knight. In the game, it's pawn takes bishop. This may seem appealing. Taking with the bishop, landing a skewer, but black has a way out with a check. So it's pawn takes, and we get some piece improvements here in this ending. Kings both improve, the rooks get to, I guess, the very best squares, the black rooks I'm speaking of. This one is a passive rook. Now, in this position, white continues with rook e1, and black is now winning. Can you find Fischer's winning combination? Feel free to pause the video. Okay, when you're up some material, you should always be looking for ways to give it back and still emerge the better side. Black has a perfect opportunity right here, and that is to take the bishop with check, take the pawn with check, take the rook, and this is now a winning king and pawn ending. Why? Well, the black king takes up this wonderful post on c4. But here's the detail, the big point. In this king and pawn ending, an outside passed rook pawn is king. With b6, we're supporting now a5. Black's going to have a passed rook pawn. So how does this play out after king c2? There's some play on the king side with g5. It's not necessary. Black can already push with the a pawn, but he goes with the g pawn first. And still doesn't play a5 here. He plays f4. So a little note on this move. It's not a requirement to play f4, but I think it goes to show the mentality of Fischer in a way. He's trying to still be precise in this king and pawn ending, even in a position where precision isn't a requirement. He could still win right away by pushing the a-pawn. Why is he going with f4 rather than g4? I think it's because you would like to fix this pawn as a target, since it's closer to the black king. So only after fixing the f-pawn does he now bolt with the a-pawn. And what's going to happen? The white king is pulled away to the edge. He is now outflanked by the black king. And black is able to simply scoop up all of these pawns now on the king side. It's at this point that white simply resigns. If the game continues, black can simply win every pawn if he wants to. And of course, this is completely winning. But this one goes no further. After move 43, king e3, Lombardy resigns. So, what'd you think of this one? Anyhow, feel free, as usual, to leave any feedback to this video in the comment section below. I hope you enjoyed it, and maybe took a thing or two away. That's all for now. Take care. Bye.